And I have here with me Nagesh, Pabisetty. Nagesh is the General Manager of Unified Communications and CRM Practice at Microsoft India Development Center. In his prior roles at Microsoft, Nagesh was responsible for live meeting, Xbox casual games, and educational products. Nagesh joined Microsoft in 2005 when he moved to India after living in US for 20 years. And prior to Microsoft, Nagesh was Vice President of Consumer Products and Support for Rail Networks. Now, he loves traveling and he's traveled, notice, 40 out of 50 states in the United States and 11 out of the 28 states in India. And he's still counting. He's been here only for 6 years now. So go there, Nagesh. Then I have Kanna, Ramasubramanian from Microsoft again. He's the Principal Group Program Manager at the Windows Division at the Microsoft India Development Center in Hyderabad. In his current role, Kanna works on upcoming releases of Windows 8. In the past, Kanna worked on incubations and evangelized product and solution ideas aimed at consumers in emerging markets to business leaders and executives within the company. Now, Kanna is a wannabe script writer, so you will have some Bollywood and Tamil movies that Kanna would be script writing in the future. And he's also an avid armchair mountaineer. So, the third panelist we have is Hamsa, Seshan. She's the director from Delivery Excellence Group, Global Delivery at IBM India. And she's responsible for excellence in delivery to world clients from the Global Business Services team, which is nearly around 50,000 strong. She is a veteran of IBM. She's worked with IBM now for past 16 years and has served in several positions and is labeled as a change agent, has worked really well in stressful situations and really big complex projects. She began her career in the financial services in IT industry, and she holds a bachelor degree in computer science. Now, she is an observer of people. Please look out. If she's looking at you, she knows what type of a person you are and what's your personality type. What kind of a question are you going to ask for? Okay. So the other thing also I'd like to let you know is I have some freebies. I'll be giving away those are Windows phone cases. So for those of you who come up with really good questions, I have them in limited numbers. So I will hand it out to those who have very limited, very really good questions coming up. So let's rock and roll. I'll set the context or the direction as to what do we plan to do with this event. I was binging yesterday about program management and trying to draw parallels on what program management would be like in different industries. And I came up with a couple of analogies, and people, you please feel free to disagree with me as well. So I thought a program manager in the Bollywood would be somebody like Farah Khan, who makes the best of masala movies, because she would put the comedy angle, she would put the romance angle, the ma factor. She'd get really nice, cute heroines to do really nice item numbers for her, and she'd come up with a masala movie which will have a mix of everything. And then I was looking at A.R. Rahman, who's come up with these really beautiful compositions over the past decade or so and has won an Oscar for us. Then I was also looking at J.K. Rowling, who's I think the best storyteller I have seen in the past decade or so. I mean, we used to wait in lines to get to read the next book, and used to wait for years, months together for the book to release, and then to get a sneak peek of the new book that is coming up. So a program manager, to my mind, is a person who is a binding factor in all the projects, who brings in is the common thread, who connects all. He's the brain and the nervous system of a project. So that is what is program manager to me. I'd like to like the speakers also to share their versions of what program management means to them, starting with Nagesh.
Yeah, I really like the analogy of the conductor of an orchestra or the producer of a movie, as you shared. The way I'm thinking about it from at least the technology industry is I want to relate to you at least a few roles that you see in the industry and kind of get them packaged for you as how program management is talked about and practiced in Microsoft, companies like Microsoft. So we all know about product management, and you know, coming from an FMCG company, you would think of 4 P's. Take just the first part of it, essentially the product part of it, right? Understanding the customer, understanding the market, and translating that into a product vision, a set of scenarios, and a set of features. And that's kind of the first P part of the 4 P's in marketing that's packaged into what Microsoft practices. The second element to program management as practiced in Microsoft is, again, with project management. The third element being systems engineering. So these three elements together form program management in Microsoft. The second part, which we talk about systems engineering, is taking that product vision that the first P talks about and converts that into specifications, kind of when they need to be delivered, how they need to be built. The first is the what part of the P, and the second one is the how part of it. And the last element is the conducting the orchestra, right? It is the project management element with resources, budgets, risk management, escalations, and essentially landing the ship. So the combination of these three is what the unique role that Microsoft has is program management. And I take a lot of pride in that being quite empowering and something that you feel kind of in charge, if you will, to be able to get things done by collaborating with a wide array of people, and you're the kind of the first stop when something needs to get done. And that, for me, is what program management is all about.
Kanna, would you like to share your thoughts?
Sure. I think the first thing that comes to mind is the irony of the name, because you get asked that quite often, right? Neither are you a programmer nor are you a manager, so what the hell are you? So I think that element of ambiguity is by design in the role, at least when I talk about program management in Microsoft. But the one common thread to all the roles that you talked about, whether it's a Farrakhan or an Rahman or Yehudi Menuhin or whoever, it's about knowing very, very intimately what it is that the audience wants. And that's the crux of it. Yes, after that, everything falls into place. Crystallizing those requirements, delivering those requirements in a language that your developers and your testers and your designers understand, taking that and developing a project plan for releasing it, getting it out there in the market, and then validating that what you did was right so that you can go ahead and correct those mistakes in later releases. So the common thread, if you notice across all of these efforts, is reaching out and understanding the customer. And that, to me, is the most integral part of it. So the way I look at program management is there are three distinct phases to a program manager, at least in a product division, which is the first part is the learn part. And this applies to how many of our products you do across your entire career, every product you go through this. The learn part is where you understand what it is that you're going to build, which primarily means understanding who your customers are, in what context is your product going to solve their problems. So you go do things like, you know, first and second level of research. You go do contextual inquiry. You go, you know, do real people, real data, sit in people's homes, understand the context of their problems, and have a very intimate understanding of who it is that you're designing a product for. And then you do the next level of understanding, which is what is the market space like? Where are the technology trends? What are the behavioral trends? What's in, what's out? What's the competition doing? So you have the learning phase. And the output of that learning phase is really a set of prioritized features that you're going to build for your product. And then comes the speccing phase, which is where you translate all this learning into something very, very concrete that can be developed by somebody who doesn't have as intimate a knowledge of the customer as you do, but that's your job, transcribing that understanding onto those specifications. And what serves the specification for the testers to be able to validate that this indeed truly is what the program manager had the vision for. And then finally, you know, like Nagesh said, where the rubber meets the road, you still have to deliver this. You need to make those hard calls on, okay, I can continue to keep building this because I'll never get the ship out the port if I don't. And so you make the hard cuts, you make the most important decisions at all times, making sure that every decision you make, you ask yourself the question, is this decision relevant to the customer that I'm building this for, right? So learn, spec, deliver. To me, this is program management.
That's really good. So customers speak, devs speak, tests speak. Absolutely. And just keep speaking for
yes,
program
keeping,
management.
Keeping on speaking is an increasingly important attribute that program managers need to have more and more, because the devs and the tests and the designers and the various people, they don't report to you. So you're going to have to get them on your side and get them to do what you will them to do. And the only weapon you have on your side, other than, you know, an intimate understanding of the customer, is the gift of your GAM.
So,
yes.
Can we get a mic there, please? So before you ask a question, can you call your name out and from which organization and what role you play?
From Symantec, and I'm a senior manager.
Can't quite hear you.
I'm Sudha from Symantec. I take care of, I'm responsible for the engineering of a product line.
Okay.
So I have a question for you. Does the program manager have the authority to determine when the product will go out? Since it is a more of a, since there are multiple parties involved, if each of them slips,
yeah.
What is the authority that the program manager can have on these three parties to make sure we hit the market at the right time? I don't see the empowerment in the program management office.
Each company has a particular dominant philosophy of what program management is. The key thing to find is find a place where program management really is empowered to make the kind of decisions that you should. So customer advocacy, he talked about. And second is the set of criteria that you will use to be able to make a ship decision or a no ship decision, right? That needs to be clear up front. And there are companies, believe it or not, where program managers are empowered to be able to make those decisions. They're accountable for it. And people look up to them to make those decisions. And not going out on a limb, but really having the rest of the people with you along this whole process. Very much like conducting an orchestra, if you will. I mean, you need to get the rest of the people to line up. Otherwise, you need to make the right decisions to, make sure that you have the right team that's going to deliver.
If I might add very quickly onto that. So I'm a program manager in Windows. It's a huge, humongous organization. Clearly, I don't have the authority to stop shipping a Windows. Somebody way up there does. But I do have the authority to stop ship off my feature within Windows, and I do have the authority to say, I'm going to cut this part of my feature because what little I do, I want to do it really well, as opposed to doing 10 things and doing all of the media. So that level of authority I completely have.
So Hamsa, do you want to share your thoughts? I'd like to hear about crisis management, working under stressful situations, about conflict management, how they play a really big part in program management's role.
Okay. Can you hear me? Okay. So a couple of reasons why I have to be different, right? Microsoft, IBM, guys, I'm a woman. I thought it was important because they're both going to talk about how you need to do things right. I thought I'd talk about what do you do when things go wrong. And more often than not, we are put in these kind of testing situations. So what do you do? So a lot of what they said is absolutely applicable, except that you don't have the luxury of now going to the user's home and gathering requirements, because perhaps somebody's already done that and botched it, and now you've got something, you don't know whether it's right or wrong. So you're typically in these kind of situations, when you go in as crisis manager, I would say, I will just articulate some of the keeping all the principles that they talked about in mind, I will talk about some attributes that you need to focus on, or characteristics. So I think the primary thing that we would require is, first of all, courage of conviction in a crisis management situation. Why do I say that? At first, it may appear to you that, if I turn this around, this is great heroics, and I'm going to be very recognized. But trust me, it's a lot of hard work. So when you get in there, if you're not able to call a spade, then That's the day one, you end everything. So first of all, very, very important attribute, courage of conviction. Secondly, clarity in thought and articulation. If you're not clear about what you want to do, what you want to see, and through that clarity, if you're not able to reach the things that they said, which is what they originally set out to do, if you're not able to understand and figure that out, then you're not going to be able to proceed. So that's very important in terms of what you think, what you understand of what was proposed and how you articulate this. Then the very important thing is at all times, it's very, very, very necessary to remember the big picture, just like what he just said. I may not have the authority to stop all of Windows, but I have the authority to stop a certain feature because I'm taking a call, better do it right, and it's all right if you're not able to ship that feature out. And that's the big picture view. Because now you're aligning to what your big strategic goals are. Now you're aligning to what your company brand stands for. Now you're aligning for what your client wants. Can I live without a particular feature in Windows? Perhaps I can. But can I live with something which is going to be very buggy? No, as a customer, we're going to get upset. So that is really what I'm saying is the big picture view. Now, having said that, once you get the big picture view, it's also very necessary for you to have the ability to dig deep. So the famous thing in IBM is you need to have the ability to move like the W, the letter W, this way, right? Which is, you should have the ability to look at it 30,000 feet, then you should have the ability to get down to the depth as needed, then go right back up if you need to scale up and look at the big picture. So that ability is very important. I don't believe that any of us would get to a program management or project management level if we did not have a basic understanding of the subject matter expertise. So to that extent, I would say that's a given. Why is that a given? Because if you're doing program management or project management, you need to command the respect. And you're going to be able to command the respect only if your team members think that you're going to understand what I'm going to say. Otherwise, the guy will just walk up to you and say, you know, this can't be done. And you may not know what he's saying if you ask him why. So a subject matter expertise is kind of a given. If you don't know it, at least get to know it. That's necessary. Couple of other very important, just two other important things is one is the people skills. In a turnaround project, you must have the people skills, absolutely. It is the most important elements of what, how you read the people, what you see, how you understand. Now you've understood that, you've understood the big picture, you've got a clarity, you communicate excellent, you know your subject matter, then what do you do? I think the final thing I would say is focusing on the styles of management. No one style fits every situation. You should have, again, the ability to understand perhaps this situation needs a very authoritative style. Some other situation needs a very coaching style. You will have to decipher that. That you will be able to decipher if you understand the big picture, again, the courage of conviction to call out what you see, etc. So I think those are very important attributes to be able to successful in what you do as project or program management, as well as to turn around things.
So I'd also like to touch upon what are the similarities or the differences between a PM role in a products organization versus a services or an engineering-driven solution organization. So let's start with Nagesh. Do you want to call out the differences first?
So I can call out, you know, in product organizations, there are at least a couple of different models, and then call out the difference between product companies and online services companies. The part that I will not talk about is about any of these and professional services companies because that's out of my depth. Yeah? So if you think about product companies, there are at least two models that I've seen in vogue. One model is where the program manager is actually responsible for essentially the BOL for the complete product. And that person or a set of people essentially call the shots and run the budgets and kind of get everything done. So that's one kind of you know, program management that I've seen. The other kind of program management that I've seen is the way where it is another function that is actually at the same level, if you will, a peer level function to development and test in the case of products, where they own particular elements and kind of make the decisions for those particular elements like we talked about. Now, this is just a kind of slight difference between the two kinds that I've seen in maybe a Philips and a Xerox. I've seen the first model where I've seen Microsoft and Microsoft, other founded companies by people who've been in Microsoft, I've seen the second model. The thing where I've seen different is where in online services companies like an AOL, a Prodigy, a Yahoo, is more that the program manager is really the producer, like more like content management companies, like movies, like you talked about. That's a different kind of function where it is not just the technology infrastructure, but also actual content coming together. The customers in general are people that you probably will not touch or will not speak to at all because of the volumes involved. But you will have to kind of grasp a lot of that and put that into decision making. And so here, the difference is that content and the changing tastes in content actually cause a lot of different decisions to be made at very short order, very quick, in the case of production of online services because of the cycle times that are involved. So these are the two things that I've seen where in the large companies like, as I mentioned, Philips, Xerox, Microsoft, those, the cycle times of these packaged products are much longer. And that is changing as the online services actually takes hold. But in online services and content companies, the cycle times are very short, very quick, and decisions have to be made then and there. And it's more a probe and learn. So if something didn't work, you run an experiment, you do and then essentially turn the thing. Or do experiment in one part of the whole service and then apply it to another part of the whole service. So that's kind of where I've seen the differences between product and online services. But maybe you can talk about professional services.
Yeah, so that's a different world altogether as compared to the services world. So I would say I try and draw the comparison slightly differently. In a product company, all that he talked about is with a huge focus of leaving the mark of your brand. In a services company, the focus is all about leaving the stamp of your brand. But you can't brand yourself because you're working for a different clients. So it is keeping in mind the brand of that company, the client's company, but leaving your stamp, which means you actually have to adopt to the environment that is in a service, in a client's environment. Today, Microsoft dictates what I load. Microsoft will tell me what kind of OS I will get and what kind of memory I need to have and define the config of of a lot of things. So I'm kind of, as a user, I don't have a choice. I don't have a choice to say, no, I can't use this. If I've decided that that's going to be my environment, then I really don't have a choice. But in a services environment, the client will tell you every little thing. So it is that subtle difference that actually makes us have sleepless nights.
So for Kanna, I have another question, and not the differences and similarities of a PM. I'd like to hear about how much of technical depth do you think a program manager should have? How much of dev speak should the program manager do?
Yeah, I think technical depth is non-negotiable. I think technical fundamentals are truly what decide your ability to deliver on a product, to design a product, for a number of reasons. One is, at the end of the day, you are the carrier of technology to your end consumer. So you are going to translate the technologies that you're going to build into customer experiences, and there is no way you're going to be able to do that unless you know exactly how the technology works. So from a design point of view, it's extremely important. So even if you're just designing user experiences, you will not be able to design those appropriately to your customers unless you know what the underlying components are, how they fit together, and how those are trending. That's one. From a delivery point of view, it's extremely important because, like Hamsa alluded to earlier, you're going to be sitting in a triage room and you're going to have your dev and test sit there and go, no, this is not possible. And unless you can call their BS, your product is not going to get out the door. Right? You're going to be able to say, no, I have a design degree as well. I know exactly how this works, and here's a little prototype that I wrote up for you last night. Sure, I may not be able to write code that I can ship, but I definitely know my fundamentals so very well that you will not be able to put one past me. And which is why I think technical depth is just absolutely non-negotiable and totally required. I think there's a question. Can there be a mic?
Hi, I'm Vasanta from Yahoo. So you talked about having enough depth of technical knowledge. So what is the role of the engineering manager and development managers in triaging a situation? Because you as a program manager are not as technical as your engineering manager, which is why you are in what you are and you are where they are. So what is their role? I mean, aren't you, I mean, if there's somebody's BSing you, you would expect somebody else to take that up and say, hey, you know what, this is wrong. I don't see where a program manager is going to step down and say, technically, I think you're wrong, because I can't code anymore.
That's excellent. That's an excellent question. And when we do the triage, as a trio, right? So there's development, there's test, and program management, all three sitting together. All three of them bring different perspectives to the triage process, right? As a program manager, it is my job to make sure that whatever bug that gets resolved, won't fix, or gets resolved, fixed, is relevant to the end user experience that I'm going to deliver. So I am there as the keeper of the customer gate. So it's very important to me that that gets delivered the way I want it to. And I want to be able to substantiate my claim by saying, you can't pull this wool over me by saying technically it's impossible. I do know that it's possible. But yes, as the engineering manager, it is your job to go figure out how exactly it's done. I'm not going to sit here and say, between this architecture and this is better. That's your job. But it is definitely my job to make sure that you're not going to pull this flimsy reason to impact a user experience that I am responsible for. So is that the job of the product manager?
Yeah, in our world, it's mostly the job of a program manager. Really, the key domain and key strengths are, one is courage and conviction, and second is your ability to ask right questions and kind of precipitate the right kind of discussion. So you will never be able to be the test manager. You will never be able to be the the architect. You will never be able to be the algorithms dude, if you will, right? Really, the thing that you have to do is to be able to ask those questions and kind of precipitate it with a lot of courage and conviction, and not just surface treatment. That you say, the test guy says no, it can be done. The dev guy says it can be done, so it must not be possible to do it. Now you should actually kind of dig deeper and challenge it, right? And challenge it in an open and respectful way, and then I think the right things will happen. And this all goes to the kind of the personal, courage that and people skills that you talked about that go into really making a successful program manager.
So, what is the difference between program management and project management? So, Hamsa, would you like to take that?
Okay, so the way I look at it in the services world, a program manager is defined very differently from what you talked about, which is really a portfolio manager. A project manager is somebody who looks at a piece of work. And by classical definition of project, you mean that it has a start and a stop. And there is a piece of work, there's a definite goal, and you've defined your scope, you've got your resources, all of that stuff. So that's, as a project manager, my job is to ensure that I will prepare this, I will get this done as I have been told or as the specification given to me. And there could be multiple project managers. Now, if these are all pieces of the puzzle called windows, then a program manager has to ensure that all of these fit together. Particularly, a project manager needs to be able to deliver to the spec and do the spec very well, etc. But a program manager is the one whose responsibility is to ensure that the interfaces talk, and then you get the big picture and all of that stuff. So you collect and put everything together. So I would say that it's really more of a portfolio manager, where you bring all of this together as a collection and have them all speak the same language. Yes. It's on.
Hi, I'm Pracheta from Microsoft. Since we just spoke about project management and program management, I have this fundamental question, which I had in my mind, because program management is a lot of ambiguity whenever, in different respects it can be different, in different companies it can be different. Is it necessary to have project management experience to, you know, to get into the territory of program management?
Is it necessary to have been
in the situation as a project management first and then walk into the territories of program management?
I'll take a stab at it. The first framework that I talked about, which is product management, project management, and systems engineering, the way I look for is, if you come walk into my door with two of those, I'll make sure you're rounded with the third, right? It's kind of how I think about it, okay? Because program management is not something that's taught, that that's something that you can learn in school and come into the professional environment. Second is program manager, in my world, is a mini GM. He's the mini GM of the feature that person, he or she is actually delivering. If that is the case, then you need sufficient depth to be able to kind of go after some flimsy decisions or improper decisions that could be made. So if you think that, to going back to that, either product management and project, if you have, then come into the whole program management function, or you come from the technology discipline that you have systems engineering and ability to kind of do project management elements. By that, I don't mean a role, but your capacity and competencies. Not this is not that you have to have a punch card and kind of go there and spend a few years at that booth and then go on to the next booth kind of thing, right? So I really think that it is important to have the elements and competencies than actual experience in that area. You can develop that on the job.
If I might add to that, I think the answer to your question, if I were to answer your question on whether you need project management expertise to be a program manager, my possibly controversial answer to that would be absolutely no. I think you can get by without knowing what PERT or Gantt or CPM stands for. I don't think you need to know, go get a degree in project management. In fact, I am program managing a fairly large chunk of Windows user experience, and I don't even have MS Project installed on my machine. I don't need it. So when I do my program management, the delivery part of the program management, yes, there's obviously all these competencies and components that Nagesh referred to, but none of the tools and the tricks of the trade that are required in probably servicing a really large services delivery is applicable in this context.
I'm sure Hamsa would
disagree with me on that.
Yes.
Yes and no. I think in a services organization, if you want to be a program manager, fundamentally I would say that you need to have project management understanding and skills. I'll tell you the reason why. There are constantly situations that come up. There are constantly situations that you will have to anticipate. So if you haven't done that, if you haven't been there and done that, it's very difficult for you to anticipate these situations. Whereas in a product environment, you're sort of laying out the roadmap. In a services environment, you don't know what's hitting you. In these days, what you see in the IT world, it's almost always a multi-vendor situation. 100 different tools. The environment is very unstable. So you cannot predict this. So you need to have the project management discipline. I agree with him on the fact that you may not need to have an MS project loaded. You may not need to really be able to create a Gantt chart. But sometime in life, if you had created it, it definitely helps.
Yeah, I agree there completely, Hamsa, with you.
The other aspect.
I think you have a question.
Do you have a question? Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, hi, I'm Shalini from Infosys. So I have a lot of confusions about program management, and before you talked about the technical depth, my question was what profile a person should have to become a program manager? Is it like 80% of management and 20% of technical? But you said that technical fundamentals are important, right? Now, if I work as a technology lead, so the career options that I see in front of me whenever I discuss are around architect, being a technical architect, or being a project manager. So how should I shape up my career wherein I have to become a, if I want to become a program manager, what is that I have to do differently? Or what I have to do?
I can take that. So first of all, you know, in terms of what is an ideal profile for a program manager, I think the basis is solid technology, and I think that is, like we discussed, non-negotiable. Coming from there, what is it that, you know, diverges the path from being like a developer or a tech lead or a dev lead on to being a program manager? I think the fundamental difference is your ability to empathize with the customer. If that is something that is inherent in you, then you are likely to be a very, very good program manager, and that's probably a track that is absolutely applicable to you. Yes, you can go and do a bunch of, you know, things. You can go get an MBA if you will, but I don't think an MBA is essential to be a program manager. Sure, it'll teach you certain parts of program management, like especially when you're doing product planning, you know how to commission a research, you know how to do a qual-quant study. Those things are definitely helpful, but I don't think that's going to create that excellent program manager that you would otherwise need to become, which in my mind is just pure customer empathy. I mean, do you get off on a high just by looking at people using the things that you build? If you have that in you, then I think that's what it is.
Yeah, actually, I totally agree with what Kanna said. In fact, if you kind of go to the core, it's that relentless pursuit and intellectual curiosity. Those are the fundamental things that, you know, in the technology field that are needed for being successful. And, you know, not letting go of anything and kind of going at things doggedly, irrespective of whether they are technology issues or people issues or product issues. I think those are that is the fundamental core. On top of that, it is not about the role that you played, but it's not about the job title that you have, but it is about the experiences that you had as a part of the role that you picked up or the project that you picked up. I think those are the things. If you have the ones that are about customer empathy, if you have the ones about courage and conviction, making difficult decisions, you know, turning around projects, leading people, those are the things that you would need to be able to grow, and those are the competencies. So when you're looking from a career path and planning perspective, I would urge you to really look at, rather than what the position is, what experiences does it give me that gets me to the next stage of evolution in your career path. I'd invite you to try that for a few years.
Lots of hands.
Hello, I'm Rita from Intel. A little bit of orthogonal question. So in the market where the product deadline doesn't move, but the resources moves, there is a budget cut, how do we deal with that? There's a risk added with that, which you cannot really anticipate beforehand. So how do we deal with that as a project manager or program manager?
So as a yes, that's a real life situation. As as a project manager, I think you will need to, if in the services industry, as a project manager, you will need to discuss that with the clients, agree on what is possible, because ultimately you're signed up to deliver to something which the client has asked you for. So therefore, you will need to negotiate on that, or negotiate on the timeline, whatever is appropriate. In a product situation, I will let them take a stab at it, but I would say that perhaps you will drop some feature. Also, you will again rescope the whole thing, if that's what it comes down to. It is all about what is it that you can deliver in a given time with a given with a given set of resources in a given budget. So there's constant negotiation happening there, even with clients.
So the way, first of all, in terms of upfront planning, rather than, you know, wait for that particular situation to take place, it's about prioritizing your scenarios in a pretty linear fashion. It's not in buckets, but actually linear prioritization. And then at the time that you're doing linear prioritization, your stakeholders have nothing to lose. So, you know, less of gamesmanship is there in the room, right? So getting that linear prioritization, and then when really the, you know, the budget cut happens, then, you know, quality cost or, you know, scenario coverage, right? when you have cost cut, then you only have the other two axes to play with, right? Then if it is really looking at the value, kind of move your cut line, right, to where you need to be able to deliver, because quality is sacrosanct. So that you cannot play with. So once you do that, then I think that's where the most of the discussion needs to happen. And really test, you know, this is where courage and conviction comes into play. Really test if that deadline is a hard deadline or a soft deadline. And really push on it. Sometimes you will find out that there is some wiggle room, okay? Or that it can be split into two phases, that the most essential phase goes out first and the other stuff comes out next. So these are all things that you could do at that time, but the key thing, true north, is getting to a linear prioritization up front, which, you know, if you do it at the time that you have to make the decision, there is complete gamesmanship in the room. And it's very difficult to do the right thing.
Absolutely. And when you have good product planning, I mean, it's not necessary always that either the target shifts or the resources shift. I've actually been, surprisingly, in a number of products at Microsoft where neither shifted. And we ended up building what we set out to build. So good planning can help.
We have a couple more hands there.
Hi, I'm Payal from Amazon. So, you know, from the definitions that we started out with, there seems to be a huge overlap between product management and program management. So I'd like to understand how you differentiate and draw the line between the roles and responsibilities of a product manager and a program manager.
Yeah, so the way that parses out in our world is that product manager is responsible for pretty much all four P's, okay? Product, price, placement, promotion. And at the uber vision level, okay? And program manager is predominantly for a particular release time frame in that particular domain. So you're essentially making the trade-offs within that particular time span with, of course, peripheral vision onto what is coming next, right? So at the first P, there is an amount of tension, and I would be, you know, remiss if I, you know, if I ignore that. And that tension is actually healthy tension, because sometimes you get the hand-waving from the product management world. And the project management world is, we'd like to think, is more grounded, right? So that kind of healthy debate is all goodness. And if there are certain things that are closely held beliefs, I think that's time to actually have a tough discussion and really ask for what's the basis for it. Have we done any validation? Otherwise, it's my opinion against yours. And that kind of discussions need to happen. But other than that, there is, in my mind at least, a clear distinction. Second area is where you are kind of trying to delay either cutting a huge piece or trying to delay the project by a significant amount of time. So if it is a huge delay, then product management again comes into play, because they're kind of talking about the business plan and you know, what impacts to the business plan it would have, our competitiveness and sustainability of that competitiveness and so on. So there again, there is scope for discussion, but if it is a huge cut, then I think product managers would have a lot more to say about it. Having said all this, it's a dynamic that is highly influenced by the culture of the organization, right? And so you need to have your ear to the ground as to what the culture is, and that's essentially what really dominates you know, various decisions.
Yet another unambiguous line is program management is an engineering discipline, product management is not.
Exactly.
So I mean, I think that's fairly unambiguous.
So we'll take one more question, and there's another aspect of program management I'd like to cover. So the lady in orange.
Just a continuation of that. Can I go ahead before you go there?
Sure.
Okay, firstly, my name is Shaila. I'm from AllScripts. The question I have is, okay, if everything is going perfect and rosy, yes, wonderful. But what if two or more of the projects fail out of, let's say, 10 projects? Then who's going to be held responsible? Is it going to be the product manager or all the project managers whose job didn't go that well?
It's all her fault.
That's true. Microsoft passes it on. Yes, I think it's the project manager who's responsible.
Project.
But it was all about the integration here, right? So each of the projects did well within its own territory. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But the whole integration is what failed. Right.
So your question is it the product manager or project?
Project managers.
So we didn't talk about program.
So blame it on someone else.
I think it is the program manager in that specific case.
That's right. So we'll take one more question.
I'm Seru from IBM. I would like to know the difference between quality versus quantity versus schedule in
you
a product.
Get
yeah, quality versus quantity versus schedule in a product management or a services company.
What was the third axis? Quality, quantity?
Schedule.
Schedule. What would you want to know about that?
Which takes the priority?
As with everything in life, depends.
Okay, I'm going to take a completely unambiguous stand on that. I think quality.
Quality.
I don't think quantity matters. I don't think schedule matters. If you don't ship quality, none of these things matter.
That's right. Absolutely right.
That's true.
Does it differ in a product company and a services company?
No.
No.
It should not. If it Absolutely does, then not. You're not doing something right.
Right.
So I'd like to touch upon the aspect of influencing without authority in the program manager's role. You're responsible for the delivery of the project, you're responsible for the morale of the team that you're working with, but you do not have any authority or you do not manage the people you're working with. So how does a program manager and what qualities should the program manager have to be able to do, to influence the team towards delivery? But not having the authority to influence them the right way.
Okay, I'll take a stab at it. The underlying thing that really gives you the power of influence is the relationship. And to quote Stephen Covey, I would say relationships are like bank accounts. You can't do withdrawals without deposits. So really what you need to do is actually who are the stakeholders that you're dealing with? What are their interests and how can you set them up for success? How is it that you can help that person so that they're set up for success, in which case that they're going to help you to be able to be, you know, set up for success? I think, you know, you have to earn the currency of influence. It's not given to you, you need to earn it. There is some element that you get because of the position that you hold, but the rest is totally earned because the given position can easily be taken away or the influence can erode and then it's a free for all. So the first thing I feel is really fundamental and foundational. So if you're talking about the traits of people that would want to get into these roles, go back to your past. Were you the one that ran the giving campaign? Were you the one that ran the, you know, the morale event for your team? Were you the one that when you were in school that when the teacher said do this and you got up and kind of corralled the set of people to be able to do this? These are all things that naturally those are your traits. And I think that it is important to kind of get in touch with your inner core as to, you know, what drives you. Take the, you know, assessments, you know, if, you know, based on your Myers-Briggs or, you know, whichever else, and then see what, you know, what would be the right match for you, right? Those are all things I feel that will help you be successful from an influence without authority perspective. Second is when you don't have the authority for some of these things, see how you can align the person with authority with what it is that you're trying to say or trying to get done. And that's the other way you're identifying stakeholders and influencing them, right? And that again is a currency that you need to earn. There is no silver bullet here, and it's just that after you do a few projects, when you're appointed to do another project, then you bring that with you, and the other people also know what you made happen. That also gives you currency when you start, and then build from there rather than eroding from there. And that's, very foundational.
So we have time only for two more questions, and then we'll wrap up. I'm sure Hamsa, Nagesh, and Kanna are available. Through lunch, yes. So you can catch up with them and ask the rest of the questions. I'm sorry, I'm snubbing some of you guys. I see a lot of raised hands. Okay, the lady with the mic.
I just want to add to what Nagesh said. And I think this comes so inherently to us IBMers because we are a very matrix organization. And in a matrix organization, this is really what we live and breathe. A lot of other companies call it horizontals and verticals. So it's all the same. Whichever way you look at it, if your intersection is going to be with two or three other different parties, and then that's a matrix organization. If you want absolute control, then the construct has to be as a projectized organization. But that is now old-fashioned because we have so many more things to do. More and more companies are moving towards the matrixed organization. In a matrix organization, everything that Nagesh said holds absolutely good. And I would just give you one tip. Anytime you're talking to somebody outside of your sphere of influence, just think about what's in it for them. Because if you don't sell it to them from that point of view, you're not going to get the buy-in. And that's really what primarily helps everybody to come together, the common goal.
I'm Nina Bhatti, and I'm here from HP Palo Alto, California. And in HP, I'm a program manager, and I don't think I've ever seen one who wasn't a project manager first, because it's a very tough role to be a program manager, and the biggest thing you have is your influencing and your competency. So having delivered is a way of establishing that with an organization. If you just show up and say, I'm going to sort it out, people look at you like you're an idiot. They don't have any idea why you're even there. So you really have to build that, and that's the currency you have in an organization. And when marketing talks to you, did they actually get clarity? If design talked to you, did they get clarity? If everything is a muddle, that's the job of the program manager. There's a muddle, and you make it clear so that people can actually execute. So you bring that, and then you get bigger and bigger projects. But I think actually being a program manager is harder than being a project manager, having done both. And that you kind of don't, I wouldn't advise anybody to try to be a program manager until they've delivered one thing. Because it's just so hard to be successful. And when you get into it, you realize what a complex job it is and how hard it is to be good at it.
Absolutely.
Yes, well makes said. Sense. Yeah. So we have time for one last question. The lady in the back, yeah. We can
hear yours. Maybe it's more of a summary question, but how does your organization measure your success as a program manager?
So at least in the world that we come from, it is the entire triad is responsible and accountable for success of the product. That is dev, test, PM, all together. So the kind of things, so if a particular feature that you're responsible for or a particular product that you're responsible for does amazingly well out in the market, that's the ultimate measure of success. The rest are all derived metrics or interim metrics that get wiped out depending upon the success of the product.
So yeah, I mean, year on year, your success metric is fairly well established with the career model framework we have, which says that if you're a program manager at this level, this is what is expected of you. And it's very easy to say, you know, how well you did against those commitments. But your overall growth over a period of 5 to 10 years really depends on the metrics that Nagesh just mentioned, which is how well your products have done out there in the market, how well have they been received, and how well have you adapted to feedback and ongoing improvements to your product.
So I'll just use the two very cliched words. It's for the program manager, it's all about accountability. And maybe you could look at the project manager as having the responsibility to complete something. But no accountability goes past the program manager. It is ultimately culminates there.
Very true.
Okay. Thank you.
So yeah, we're ready to end the session now. I have chosen the 10 folks who I want to give the freebies to. So thank you so much, Hamsa, Kanna, and Nagesh. And those of you who haven't been able to ask your questions, please feel free to catch hold of them as soon as they leave this room. They're very difficult to catch hold of. Otherwise, I have never met Kanna and Nagesh in Microsoft till now. Okay, thank you so much, guys. It was fun being with you.
So fun.
Yeah.